There are some changes, yes. I changed my setting. Anything else? No? Okay, let's go. Hello everybody, welcome back to my channel. My name is Teacher Laura, and today I actually bring to you a short but very informative video about a topic that a lot of people tend to misunderstand sometimes. When we think about the word irony, we tend to think about either comical situations or situations where sarcasm is key to understand either a joke or to understand a point.
Excuse me, is this Sarcasm 101?
No, it's Lamaze class for Men Named Arthur.
Oh, okay.
Now, what exactly is the definition of irony? Margaret Atwood, in her masterclass, or in an article for masterclass, basically describes irony as the difference between what something appears to mean versus its literal meaning. Irony is often associated with both tragedy and humor. What we can basically learn from this is that irony is a contrast between what is expected and what the reality ends up to be. So if you find yourself in a situation where you are expecting to get a result, but then you get something completely different, that could become into an ironic situation. Now, there are three types of irony that we are going to learn today. Now, there are more types of irony out there. Margaret Atwood, for example, in this article describes four types of irony. However, we're going to focus on three types today. We're going to focus on verbal irony, situational irony, and dramatic irony, because all three of them are very, very different. Well, when you think about verbal irony, I know that what you're thinking about. You immediately go to sarcasm.
So nervous. Have you ever given a eulogy?
You mean at a funeral?
No, Rose, at a pie-eating contest.
Now, when everyone says, like, oh, nice dress, and they look at you like you just made the biggest fashion mistake of your life, that could be cataloged as a verbal irony. A verbal irony basically happens when you say the opposite of what you actually mean. Or, in a way, when you try to say something that is not expected. Sarcasm fits into this idea of verbal irony. However, they are not exactly the same. In that same article that I mentioned about, Margaret Atwood describes the difference between sarcasm and irony as basically the intention behind it. When you actually want to be sarcastic, you're basically being mean-spirited or having a touch of malice in your speech. That is what differentiates sarcasm from a regular verbal irony. She writes, "The key difference between irony and sarcasm is that sarcasm characterizes someone's speech. Irony can additionally describe situations or circumstances, which means that in some situations they can be considered ironic but not necessarily sarcastic. Sarcasm is all about the intention that you want to portray. If you actually want to be mean to that person or you want to make fun of them, you know, if you want to use it for mockery, that is when it becomes sarcasm. But a verbal irony perfectly fits into the idea of me saying, oh, what a nice weather we have, and it's raining cats and dogs outside, which is something that correlates with this idea of a verbal irony. So again, make sure to remember this concept. All sarcasm fits into verbal irony, but not all verbal irony has to necessarily be sarcasm. Dramatic irony is one of the literary devices that is most used not just in books, but movies, TV shows, or basically anything that you watch on social media at the moment. Dramatic irony happens when you, as the audience, knows exactly what's going to happen to a particular character. However, this character is not aware of what is going on. Now, what does this mean? We are all familiar with the movie Titanic, or at least I would hope that everyone is familiar with the movie Titanic. If we know a little bit of our history, we know that the Titanic eventually sank around 1912, if I'm not mistaken, I could be. And the movie plays around with this idea that you know that this ship is going to sink and these characters are probably not going to meet, you know, the best of endings, but you get invested into their story. And the characters have no idea of what's going on. I mean, when Rose and Jack are perfectly happy, you know, twirling around and having their all beautiful teenage romance that lasts for like, you know, just 3 hours, you get to notice that they have no idea what's going on. They have no idea that there's a mean, evil iceberg that it's about to hit their boat and it's going to fall down and they're all going to die. That is the point of dramatic irony. As the audience, you know precisely what is going to happen and you are expecting either the worst or the best. But the characters are not aware of this, and as the audience, you tend to feel some sort of suspense. It is a very effective device in the way that it gets the audience invested into what's going on, because let's be real, it will be very entertaining for you to know what the character is going to go through, and you feel that sort of suspense because this character has no idea of what's going on. Dramatic irony is used a lot in horror stories because you, as the audience, need to have this feeling of suspense. And horror movies are meant to create suspense within their audience. They are meant to create this terror, and the audience, knowing what's going to happen, have a very good clue of that a character might die or might encounter a very difficult or gorish situation in a way. So that's when the device becomes very effective. So you can find it in all sorts of shows. You can find it in music videos even. I mean, dramatic irony is everywhere. Situational irony, which is the third type of irony that we're going to study today, is actually quite an interesting device. Basically, the characters and you as the audience are expecting something to happen, but then something completely different occurs and everything, you know, either goes very well or goes very badly. Irony is, in a way, what the writers of Game of Thrones tried to do with their season finale and completely failed at, because they went into the idea of subverting expectations. When you subvert your audience's expectations, it's because you are basically trying to let them know that what they expect is not exactly what they are going to get. However, the blurred lines and misunderstanding of subverting the expectations is what made the show eventually have so many fans become incredibly angry. I mean, I can count like 10 videos or 15 that I have watched already of people complaining about the finale, and you can watch them probably. I'm pretty sure you can find like 150 more. Some of them are really good, so any Game of Thrones fans out there, I recommend that you watch some of those videos. There's a great analysis, but one of my favorite literary analysis, which is analyst, which is Lindsay Ellis. I will link in the description down below, because she makes a very good analysis on how this idea of subverting the expectations, subverting the tropes, actually failed. With situational irony, you have to be very careful, because in order for this to work, you need to be able to surprise your audience and even surprise the characters. Going back to that Game of Thrones example, they did this very well at the beginning of the show. And even in the books, George Martin is a master at handling situational irony. What is the best example? Ned Stark's fate. Ned Stark is brought to trial and eventually they are going to execute him. But if he confesses and if he relents in his speech and declares Joffrey to be, you know, almighty king, they will forgive him and they will pretty much allow him to join the Night's Watch and, you know, forget about him ever existing. But by Joffrey deciding to do completely the opposite and murdering him anyway, let's face it, one of the stupidest decisions he's ever made for himself, it subverted the audience's expectations of the hero not always making it, which is what I believe George Martin's intentions were writing this book. I think that he really wanted to go in a different direction from one of his inspirations, Tolkien, in which the hero wins in a way, although That really doesn't happen in Tolkien either, or in Lord of the Rings. But situational irony, if used correctly, can become a great device, because you as the audience have no idea what is going to happen, or have an idea of what's going to happen, but then everything is turned on its head. The characters also have no idea that this is going to happen, and they expect one thing, but boom, they get something else. If used correctly, these three devices are very, very useful when it comes to not only developing a show or writing the script for a movie, but also when developing books. All of these ironies are incredibly important, and you can find them in almost all literary works. If you actually sit down to watch Disney movies, they are all great examples of ironies. For instance, Toy Story is a giant example of dramatic irony. The toys basically knowing that they are alive, and the humans not knowing that they are alive. But we as the audience know that the toys are alive. That is a giant dramatic irony. I mean, verbal irony examples you can find all across the Marvel universe. I mean,
Rhodey, careful on re-entry. There's an idiot in the landing zone.
Oh, God. What's up, regular size man?
And situational irony is also something that you can find in Disney movies all the time. So these devices, if used correctly, can become very successful. But it's very important that we learn to differentiate them so that we know exactly how to use them well and make our writing eventually more successful. Thank you so much for watching this video. Today I decided to do a short one because it's very important to analyze these three types of irony, and I wanted to make sure that you had a clearer idea with some examples on how we can make irony work, especially because it is a very, very cool topic, and I think I've repeated this like 125 times already, but if used correctly, they become great, great devices. Once again, thank you so much for watching. Remember that if you want to watch more of this type of content, don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell for notifications. If you have any requests of topics or something that we should talk about, leave your comments down below. And don't forget, I mean, any suggestions are also very well received. Thank you so much, and I'll see you next time. Bye, everybody. I'm feeling that. Flowers, I'm feeling the hair, I'm feeling my fantasy girl.